Hey, welcome to West Church. My name is Andrea Smith, and I have the awesome privilege of being the pastor here. If you are checking us out in live stream on Sunday morning, or if you are watching or listening on demand, or if you are checking us out via podcast, we are so glad that you have taken a few minutes out of the busyness of life to worship with us and to hear the message that we have for you this morning. We are talking about prayer, and we are talking about whether or not it matters. And today is really exciting because we're going to talk about not just praying for ourselves, but praying for one another. We're going to talk about the word please. So I'm so grateful that you're taking a few minutes to listen to this message. If you are new to the West community, if it's the first time that you've watched or you've listened, we want to give you a special thanks, and we have a special gift for you. You can text the word welcome to the number that you see on your screen right now, or I'm going to read it in just a second so you can jot it down or enter it in your phone. But we're so glad that you're here, and we want to send you a gift for you. So if you would text the word welcome to 704-343-8955, 704-343-8955. We have a gift, and then you can choose whether you want to hear from us again or not. That's totally up to you. But we're grateful that you have taken some of your time to check out what West is all about. Actually, we are a church that has no physical building that we own. We have a beautiful relationship with Lake Norman High School, and we worship there on Sunday mornings live at 10 a.m. And we also have our office space, our warehouse here that we have a production studio in. And so we put on seasonal events to try to make a difference in the community and show people that we really care about folks that are not necessarily within the West community, but those that are outside of the West community. This actually comes into play a little while later in the message, but I wanted to say right now just a huge thank you to all who supported our Halloween extravaganza, our trunk or treat. We have no idea how many people came. We made 200 amped boxes. That's our online children's character development, children's ministry, children's worship experience. We made 200 of those boxes to give away. They were gone within an hour, and those were only for a certain age group of children. We had 500 full-size candy bars that we were giving. Those ran out. We had scavenger hunts, and we had pizza, and everything that we had, we ran out of last night. We had folks that were so generous to do trunks and give candy out of their trunk, and multiple of them said, I just didn't think the line would ever end, and we felt that way too. A huge thanks to Dawn Lynch, our staff person who spearheaded this event. Dawn's a great leader, and she made this happen last night and pulled it off, and I still am not sure how. Just a huge thank you to her. But we wanted you to see the impact that you had in people's lives. And like I said, I'll elaborate this a little later in the message, but Josh worked extra hard last night, as he always does, and put a video together for you just so you could see what your financial dollars, if you support West Church through your tithes, through your offerings, through your financial generosity, you make things like last night happen. If you don't support West but you'd like to, you can always go to our website, headingwest.org, and click the give button. We welcome any donations that we receive, but it is your money and your prayerful support that we're able to do things like last night. We figure there had to be around 1,500 people there because we served well over 500 children, probably 600 to 650 different children and their families. So it was a huge event and a tremendous success. And so thank you for making it be that way. I invite you to check out this video.
Something weird. I ain't afraid of no ghosts. I ain't afraid of no ghosts.
She's right. Let's go.
Oh, come on. It's just a bunch of hocus pocus.
Max, I'm not kidding this time. It's time to go. Max, no!
Uh-oh.
So this morning we are talking about, does prayer actually work or is it just hocus pocus? And this morning we are going to talk about using the word please. In previous weeks we've talked about saying the word here, that when we just simply say here, we open ourselves up to the presence of God that exists within each of us. And then we also talked about using the word help and using the word thanks. And so this morning we are going to talk about the word please. And it's a little bit of a different kind of message. We've been talking about how do we pray so that we feel the presence of God and what happens when, like, we feel disconnected and all that kind of stuff. So this morning, I want us to pause for just a few minutes and think about, so not only is it about us feeling the power and the presence of God for ourselves, but what about all of humanity? What about one another? And the word please, it actually opens us up and it draws this connection with us and all people. And so I want us to look at that for a few minutes. So this morning, I want you to think about the question, do you want to be like in the front row of the best stadium seats ever? Or would you rather be like on the field? And I'm going to use the field analogy, but if like you have no desire to play any sport ever in your lifetime, what if you were in the entertainment industry? Would you rather have the front row best spectator seats ever? Or would you rather be up on the stage? So years ago, in one of my ministry appointments, there was a young man, and if you're a preacher, you're appointed somewhere, so that's why I use that word, or if you're a United Methodist preacher or pastor, you're appointed somewhere. But years ago, in one of my appointments, I had a young man in the youth group that I was the youth pastor for, and he was the star quarterback of their football team. He was an amazing quarterback, actually. And he was, too, one of the most humble, kind young men ever. And he started coming to the youth group with one of his friends. His family went to a sister church, and he started coming hanging out with our youth group. I got to know him over the 4 years that he was in high school, and was just really sad when he moved on and went away to college. He went to Appalachian, and he was a walk-on for their football team. Now, this was many, many, many years ago, and ASU was fine in their football. ASU Appalachian is my alma mater for two of my degrees, and so I love ASU, love their football, but it was just not that big of a deal back in the dark ages when I went there. So I didn't really think a lot about it when this young man was a walk-on. I mean, lots of young adults make it to college teams to play, and so I was happy for him, but didn't spend a lot of time pondering it. And then right before the year started, he had had to move up there early so he could be involved in all the practices and stuff. And right before the year started, he called me and asked if we could talk. And he said, you know, I've made a decision that I hope you're not disappointed in. You know, I respect your opinion, and I've shared this with my parents, and as my pastor, I'd like to share this with you. The football, it just isn't my heart anymore. It's not what makes me happy, and I'm worried about the rigors of academic work, and I've done football all my life, and I just don't have it in me, and I don't want to play. And he said, so I have dropped off the team. And I told him that, you know, he needed to do whatever he and his parents felt best. And so he shared with me his parents' thoughts and concerns, and also their decision to support him in doing whatever he needed to do. And so he went through his college career and has a very, very successful life right now. But several years after his college career was over and he graduated and had a job, I ran into him at a wedding for someone, and he said, you know, I have one huge regret. And he said, I'll never forget that I could have had a chance to be on the winning team. Back when ASU, it has been touted by some to be the biggest upset in college football, when ASU beat Michigan, he would have been on the football team then. And that was in the height of ASU's heyday as an amazing national championship football team and conference championships. They had years and years and years of success. And this young man would have been on that team the whole time. But he decided that that wasn't for him, and he stepped away. This morning, I want you to think about, are you wanting to be like on the field of life and playing whatever your favorite sport or pastime is, or your favorite entertainment is? Or do you want to be doing it, or do you want to just be sitting by and watching? That actually transfers to religious world too, because sometimes we are the best religious bystanders ever. It's so easy to sit on the religious sidelines and just watch everything that's happening, question everything that's happening, even criticize everything that's happening. And I would like to propose to us this morning that there's an alternate path. Instead of being the criticizer or the questioner or the observer, what if we're actually a doer? And what if one of the ways that we do is through our prayer? What if we started understanding that our prayer is one of the things that gets us on the field, in the arena, on the stage? What if instead of just observing and criticizing and questioning and theorizing, what if we really started letting our prayer life be something that propelled us into actually exercising the same love and the same compassion that's been given to us? So I want to share with you a story this morning. It is from the Gospel of Mark. And as I read the scripture this morning, I want you to watch and look at the image that is on the screen. What you see before you is an image of an ancient house that would have been found in Capernaum or Jordan or Jerusalem. It's a mud house. It's the way that they would build their homes, with mud and stone. And on the roof, you'll see the roof on the screen. Some of the roofs were solid like that because the homes would be built up instead of out. Some of the homes, though, had thatched roofs. And the home that I'm going to read to you about this morning, we don't know if it was a thatch roof or a mud roof or what kind of roof that it was. And frankly, that's irrelevant. But what I want us to think about is the action that some folks took to not be bystanders, but actually be participants on the field. If you've heard this story before, the friends that carry their friend, I'd invite you to hear it again this morning with fresh ears. And if you haven't heard the story, it's such a powerful story about compassion and about people who were willing to say please to God on behalf of their friend. After a few days, Jesus returned to Capernaum. Word got out that he was back at home. A crowd gathered, jamming the entrance so no one could get in or out. And he was teaching the word. They brought a paraplegic to him, carried by four men. When they weren't able to get in because of the crowd, they removed part of the roof and lowered the paraplegic on the stretcher. Now, impressed by their bold belief, Jesus said to the paraplegic, "Son, I forgive you of your sins." Some religion scholars sitting there started whispering among themselves, "He can't talk that way. That's blasphemy. God and only God can forgive sins." Jesus knew right away what they were thinking, and he said, "Why are you so skeptical? Which is simpler, to say to the paraplegic, 'I forgive your sins,' or say, 'Get up, take your stretcher, and start walking'? Well, just so it's clear that I am the Son of Man and authorized to do either or both," he looked at the paraplegic and said, "Get up, pick up your stretcher, and go home." The man did it. He got up, he grabbed his stretcher, and walked out with everyone there watching him. They rubbed their eyes, stunned, and then they praised God, saying, "We've never seen anything like that." Now, a couple of parts that are interesting to note is that when the religion scholars were sitting there watching all this happen, they started whispering to themselves like, "What's that? What's that? What is he doing? That's wrong." Are we the religious scholars? Or are we the people on the field? So I want to show you a picture of, it is the biggest stadium. It's the biggest football stadium in America. I did not believe this fact to be true. Like when I was doing my research for the message today, I was looking at all these different stadiums, the biggest stadiums in the world. And I figured it'd be like, you know, the Dallas Cowboys or something like that. And there were several in other countries. And then the first one in America was Michigan's stadium. I'm like, surely a college football stadium is not bigger than a professional football stadium, but it is. And so I want you to get a sense for the vastness of this stadium. It is bigger than the Panthers stadium by about 40,000 seats, I believe. It's huge. So I want you to picture yourself, and what if you're there at a Michigan football game, even if you don't like Michigan as a football team, what if you're there in the crowd? What if you're sitting on one of those rows and you're just engulfed with all these other people and you're watching what happens down on the field? Are you happy to sit there in the middle of all the people and get caught up in that? Or do you actually want to be one of the people down on the field? Maybe a cheerleader, maybe the mascot, maybe one of the players. Where do you want to be? Where do you want to be in your life? Do you want to be one of the religious observers that sits around and criticizes everything and everyone? Or do you want to be someone like one of those friends that cared enough about their friend that even though he didn't say, hey, can you guys like pick me up and like lower me through the roof? That's on my list of things to do today. They didn't even get asked by him to do something for him. They took it upon themselves to do it for him in spite of being asked. They were his stretcher bearers. So do you want to be just sitting in the masses and observing? Or take a look at this image. It's two service people that serve in our armed forces carrying a stretcher. So I want us to think for just a few minutes about the very nature of God. So God, who resides in each of us, and prayer connects us to God, the nature of God is good. Goodness overcomes evil. The nature of God, who God is and how God is beautiful. And that beautiful nature of God, it overcomes the ugliness of humanity. And the nature of God, it is so vital and it is so alive that it overcomes any sickness and toxicity that exists in our world. So I want us to really, really understand who God is. God is all good. God is beautiful. God is powerful. And God is so positive and so full of life and energy that God, that power, that presence, that love, that energy, it overcomes all the negativity that exists in this world. That's why we say that the worst things are never the last things, and the last things are the most beautiful things. And our prayer life, it connects us to that in the here and now. That's why we can say that the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God is at hand, because we do embrace that the nature of God is good and beautiful and all-encompassing. But we have to connect to it. We have to join in with that. And sometimes that means that we get off of our rear ends and we get out of the seats and we go do something. So there's this phrase that actually was very controversial in the early church. It's called the priesthood of all believers. We believe in the priesthood of all believers. And actually how this phrase came into being was it was the Protestant. So remember, like ancient religion, Catholicism was the predominant world religion that worshiped Christ, the resurrected Christ. And then Protestantism branched off from Catholicism. Martin Luther started Protestantism. And so it came upon this phrase that we believe in a priesthood of all believers, saying that you don't have to have a clergy person, you don't have to have a preacher or a pastor to be able to connect with God, that anyone can connect with God. And so that was one understanding of the phrase, but then a deeper understanding of the phrase is that we are all priests. that actually you really don't, which is true and is a little scary, because if the world acted this way, I would totally be out of a job. But we're all priests. We're all pastors. We're all ministers. That's why here at West, we'll say that Dawn Lynch, who is a leader here at West, she is a minister. Lexi is a minister to her people. You are ministers. You don't have to have a religion degree to be a minister. We are all ministers to one another. We are all priests. A priesthood of all believers. We're all joined in together, being the love and the energy and the catalyst to helping all people encounter God. Now, that phrase can be a little tricky because it's like a priesthood of all believers. So does that mean we are set apart? No, it doesn't. It means we are called to use the gifts that we've been given, the energy and the power and the presence of that awareness of knowing that God exists in each of us. And we are called not to sit on the sidelines, but we are called to go out and to love all people. And so really what the church made this phrase be about is that we all should connect to God deep within us, and then we should go and we should stop worrying necessarily about who is in the little religion club, and we should be so hyper-focused on what is out there, who is out there, who needs to connect with that divine love. You know, there are so many folks that are done with religion and done with church. In today's world, there are more people every day that don't want to identify with an institutional church, but they do want to identify with spirituality, and they do want to identify with a God. It's just what understanding of God. So we stand as a church in a time where it is more important now than ever what we do, how we do it. And frankly, it is what holds us together as a church. It's why we do things like the Halloween extravaganza. We know that it is a pathway. It is a vehicle, a way for us to reach people that are never going to like just hop on to headingwest.org on Sunday morning. I dreaded yesterday when we met on Tuesday's staff meeting days. And when we met, I'm like, okay, so how many trunks do we have? And I got the answer, and it was less like by half of any of the trunks, any of the years we've ever had this event. And it's the first year we've had it since the pandemic, like that people could get out and go do things. So we were a little afraid that we were going to have a little bigger crowd than normal. I'm like, we've got to have more trunks than that. That's not a sustainable number. And so we started talking about the event. We were going to have some games, and we were going to have crafts, and we were going to give away cotton candy and popcorn. I'm like, who's going to like be the one to make all this and do all this, and just asking questions. And we all were a little perplexed. We're like, I don't know. We don't have many volunteers that have signed up for the event yet. I'm not telling you this story to guilt trip you. I'm just telling the story as an example. So bear with me for just a minute. So I'm like, well, let's make some personal ask. And so we started talking about all the people that had said already that they couldn't help because they were out of town. And that list was huge. I'm like, oh my goodness, these are all the people that normally make this one event happen. I'm like, what about A, B, and C? We made a few more asks, and we got all the spots filled. And frankly, I wasn't really worried about not having enough volunteers until I live down Perth Road, and so every day for the past week, I've driven up and down Perth, and there's this large sign that said, use caution, event October 29th and 30th. I'm like, is there a big race? Like, is there some kind of like triathlon or marathon or bike race that we're going to, you know, shut down part of this road? And then last night, or actually yesterday morning when we got here to put some of the cotton candy and popcorn together, Brad shared with me, he's like, Rocky Mount just must know somebody in the police or like the DOT to get one of those signs. I'm like, that sign's for Rocky Mount's Halloween? I love Jamie Hamrick. He is an amazing pastor. And some of the West folks that have not been able to be at West because we don't own a building, they've gone to Rocky Mount. And I don't see us in competition with Rocky Mount. So our blessings go to folks that we just aren't it for them. And so we say, okay, go. Just as long as you find a church, we're happy. But I did have some envy. Like, it's not a competition, but I was envious last night, multiple times yesterday as I drove up and down Perth Road, and I saw this nice parking lot, and I saw this beautiful building, and I thought, they don't have to, like, scrounge for tables or bring generators or any of these other things that we have to do because they have this big building, and when you have a big building, you have tons of people and all these things. And so when I finally was coming back to the Halloween thing yesterday afternoon, I'm like, I don't even know why we do these stupid things. We shouldn't do them. It's too much work. It's killing the staff. It's too hard. It costs too much money. I don't think it's worth it at all. As irony would have it, and then I thought, we're not going to have anybody come. We're going to have like 100 people. And then as irony would have it, the line literally never seemed to stop. And at one point, cars were parking on Dooley Road, which is the road that you drive up to Lake Norman High School. And Lake Norman High School is a huge property. So they were parking on the sides of the road and walking the rest of the way so that they could get there sooner. And the trunks just kept giving out candy. And it was entirely way more people than we ever imagined. We were promoting the next message series at this event. We are very strategic with our marketing when we do things like this. We try to get our name and our logo and certain things in their hands that will make them like check us out or worship with us. And so the next message series that we're going to do, the logo is based off of Squid Game. I'm actually going to be talking about Squid Game for two Sundays, and why is it so popular all across the world? Now, if you've not watched Squid Game, I am not advocating for you to go watch it now. It is a gruesome, gruesome TV show. But it is number one, or was number one, on Netflix for like 4 or 5 weeks across the globe, and everyone is talking about it. It is our job as a church to be the people on the field, not be the religious spectators sitting in the cushy seats going, can't believe they did that, or they should act like this, or they should act like this. It is our job to actually be down there on the field, figure out what plays are being played, and then engage in the game, because guess what? Faith is not a game. And there is going to come a time in everyone's life where we encounter hurdles that are just too big for us to cross alone. We are going to find ourselves just like that man, the paraplegic, who could not find it within himself to walk. And we are going to need people to help us be lowered through a roof. We are going to need people who their faith is going to be what makes us well, not our own. And it is the job of the church to figure out where people are, how are they hurting, what are they wrestling with, and the only way we're going to figure that out is to be a part of the world and be a part of the culture that we are surrounded in. So don't send me emails about, I can't believe you're doing Squid Game. I actually had one of the ladies at Halloween sort of bless me out for that last night. And I thought it was interesting. You don't even go to church here and you're fussing at me. My name tag didn't even say pastor, which I thought it did at the time. I never looked at my name tag. And so last night when I got home, I'm like, oh, it just says staff. I'm like, she didn't even know I was the preacher. And she was fussing at me about Squid Game. But the coolest thing happened last night as I gave away these normal size or like real size candy bars, not the Halloween candy. We gave one to every adult starting out, and then there were just so many people. We ended up giving them to the kids because we had more adults there yesterday than we had kids. Everybody be like, oh my gosh, you're talking about Squid Game? It provided a beautiful pathway for me to say, hey, yeah, my name's Andrea. I'm the pastor here. And, you know, it's like this number one. And then they would interrupt me and say, oh, my gosh, yeah, it's all over Netflix, blah, blah, blah. And they would either go on to explain to me, I couldn't get past the first episode, or I've watched the whole season. And I'm like, yeah, me too. Like, I watch a little and then I have to step away because it's so horrific. I said, but you know something that's so powerful is that even in the horror, you can see humanity's goodness. And that's what we're going to talk about as a church. I ended up having a 10-minute conversation with someone who had watched the whole season. And she's like, I am just so like shocked that a church would talk about this. Can I watch you online? I'm like, absolutely. You could even come in person if you'd like, if you live around here. And she's like, this is a cool kind of church. She said, there's so many things we can learn. I said, exactly. So guess what, folks? We're not like stadium sitters. We are called to be on the stage or on the field. We are called to be the stretcher bearers. We are not called to be the religious experts. And we are called to tap into that nature of God, the goodness and the love and the beauty, the positivity, the wholeness and the healing. We are called to be all that. And not just for ourselves or the people that fit in our little groups. We are called to be that for all people. I mean, this whole passage, it can preach five or six different ways, and you can make it be five or six different message themes. Today, I just want us to think about the fact that the religious people were the ones sitting there watching and criticizing. And Mark tells us that Jesus said, it is your faith that has made him well. Not his faith, not the man that couldn't walk, but the faith of the friends, the very people that were willing to carve out a roof and lower him down. It was their faith that made him well. I want to show you a picture of the Michigan Stadium again. It's a different perspective. So on the left of your screen, this is a picture of a third row seat in the stadium. You see the vantage point. You're sitting pretty close and you can tell what's going on. But in the right side of your screen, that's from someone that was on the field. You are down there in the action. When we say the word please, there is such power in that. Please, God, give strength to those who are weary. Please, God, give help to those that are helpless. Please, God, give love to those who feel unlovable. Please, God, protect those who are unsafe and need protection. When we say the word please, it opens us up and it allows us to think about people and situations that are so much bigger than us. And it pushes us, actually, to not just be stadium sitters, but to be stretcher bearers. I encourage you this week to say the word, please. The young man that walked away from his football career. I mean, he was a quarterback, so potentially could have been a star. I wonder what it could have been like if before he gave up, he'd confessed to those that were closest to him that he was struggling. What could his life have been like if people were willing to pray for him because they knew he was hurting and tired and scared? What would his career have been like if some folks had said, please? I invite us to say, please. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, we do have the opportunity to not just sit by and watch, but actually get up out of the seats and be on the field. Whether it's with giving of our time and volunteering at things like a Halloween carnival or the back to school bash or Easter events or on Sunday mornings, manning the chat room for online worship or going to buy gift cards for teachers at Third Creek. Or whether it's holding the door open for people or letting someone go in front of us in line when we're at a store and we're in a hurry. Or parking at the back of the parking lot because other people may need a closer spot than we do. There's a million ways that we can show love and compassion to all people. But it starts with our willingness to say please. God, help us see where others may need our love and our support. And remind us it's not always about us. And hear our prayers of please. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I invite you to say please this week. Thanks for joining in.